and my love life. Many times we come to church, we are kind of confused about, okay, what's going on here? Because when we get home, when we get to school, there's a different ballgame. What our friends talk about, what our neighbors do, and what we see in the movie, Hollywood films and all that. So it's kind of confusing, and I can understand you guys because I've been there. I mean, if I told you I wasn't confused about relationship and the things they tell me in church, I'm lying to you, okay? The reason why I think I may be in a good position to talk to you about this is because I've been there, I've done that. I got a teacher.
Yes.
Amen. I've been confused. I've made my own mistakes. I've learned from my mistakes. And I think my story will be of benefit to you guys. Amen. So, if you have a Bible, I want you to open to 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 3. If anybody has NIV, I would love it so much. NIV, do you have NIV? NLT? Oh God. Alright. 1 Kings 3, 3. 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 3. Okay, we have a lot to do. I want you to rush this. I want to really rush this. Are we ready? Alright, go. Somebody should read it. 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 3. Praise the Lord. Bible said that Solomon loved the Lord, the God, with all his heart, but he sacrificed in the high places. So the exception there is that as much as he loved God, he still goes to the high places to offer sacrifice to idols. Just like so many of you guys, you come to church, and when you get back to school, during the middle of the week, you do your own thing. And you love God, yes. You're here, you have a Bible, you pray in the morning, you sing in church, you clap, and all these things that we do, you also do them. The exception is that when you leave church, you do something else. And what God wants you guys to understand, what God wants you to do, is that he wants you to remove the exception. God wants you to love him with all your heart. Can you open to Deuteronomy 6, 5? Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5. God is looking for that lady, that young man, that youth, who will love him with all his heart, with all our heart, with everything in you, that you will focus on God and God alone. You will put God as number one, as the last. You put him in the front, at the back, at the side, around you. You put him all about you. Can you read Deuteronomy 6:5? Who has opened to that?
And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart.
With all thy heart?
And with all thy soul.
With all thy soul.
And with all thy might.
And with all thy might.
Thank you, man. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, one, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. Let me explain that to you. When you love God, the kind of love that God is looking for is the love that everything around you and about you and in you will be for God. Now, let me tell you this. The love that we love for our friends, opposite gender, the same intensity of love, that is the level of love that God is asking from us. In fact, the Hebrew word for that word love, is aham. That root word means to love intimately, to love as a romantic relationship. So watch this. If you can love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, what do you have left to love people? Because God is asking for everything. He's not asking for half of your heart. He's asking for all of your heart. Now, are you telling me, oh, we're not going to date anybody? We're not going to be in a relationship again? We're not going to cut people? But I'm getting old. My body is changing. What are you telling me? So let me tell you this. God wants you to have relationship. Hello? Because if I told you that, oh, do not have relationship, I'm deceiving you guys. I'm not here to deceive you. God wants you to have relationship. He wants you to have friends when the time is right. The challenge with us is that we're trying to do the right thing at the wrong time. We're so anxious, we're so eager, because we watch it in the movie, we see it in school, people are doing it around us, so we also feel like, okay, if I don't do this, I don't feel like I'm cool enough, you know? I feel like I'm bored, I'm boring, I'm not in the vibe, I'm not in the groove, and it's as if I'm out of the show, you know? I'm like, my friends don't just, they're just going to be looking at me and they're going to be talking and messing me, you know? They won't want to relate with me, my friends will not want to associate with me, like, this guy is just not one of us, you know? So I want to feel a part of them, I want to belong, so I also want to try out what they're doing. That is how I start experimenting with sin. But what God is saying today is that do not be like Solomon, who loved the Lord, but he was still sacrificing to idols. God is saying, you will love me with all your heart. Because the Bible says something. He said that he that commits sin is of the devil. Hello? So God is asking you to give all of your attention to him. To put your heart towards the world. How can you run from sin? Let me tell you guys. It's not easy to tell you, oh, do not sin. Do not commit fornication. Do not sleep with somebody. Do not. Listen, you can't do it by your power and your own might. In your strength, you can't do anything. The only way out of this is your heart to be filled with the word of God. The Bible says that, thy word have I eaten in my heart, that I may not sin against you. So, sometimes I want to sin against God, but the word of God in my heart holds me back from sinning against God. I don't know if I'm making sense to somebody. So, if I say, pray, you can pray and still go and commit sin. But when I say, read the word himself holds you back. The word itself is the anchor for your soul. The word itself is the one that begins guiding your path and your way. The word of God himself will remove wrong people from your life, will remove wrong relationships from you. We make sure that order your path aright to the way of righteousness. We bring the right people your way, because the word in you begin to attract your kind to you. Begin to attract people that have the same spirit of God in them towards you. I don't know if I'm making sense to somebody. So the solution to overcoming sin is simply the word of God in you. You must read this word daily. Read it to the... So, how do we study the Bible? Because you can say, oh, I try to read it. I mean, mommy said we should read it. We do morning devotion, we do night devotion, we go to bed. Sometimes I fall asleep. Listen to me. You're not alone. In the beginning, when you start studying the Bible, it has to make you sleep. If it doesn't make you sleep, then you are not studying the Bible. Because the first thing the Bible will do is to test you. Are you ready for me? So, if you try to sleep off, that's one thing. Proceed. If you want to sleep, when I want to sleep, and I don't know, when I was growing up, when I want to sleep, I don't know what it is. I just want to read my Bible. Before I read one chapter, I'm sleeping already. But when the love of God comes into your heart, you cannot sleep. You keep reading and you can't stop. Well, how do you get there? That is where I'm going now, okay? I like to break it down. I don't want to just tell you big words, like you can't understand it. One thing when I was growing up, I was like, I have a problem with church. You know why? When we come to church, they tell us big words. Those words, I don't even understand what it means. And when I grew up like this, I told myself, I will never teach people in such a way that they won't understand what I'm saying. So I bring it to little forms that you can grab it, you can understand what I'm saying. Are you getting me now? So how do we study the Bible that we don't sleep? One by one. We study the Bible prayerfully. Before you carry the Bible to read at all, you have to say, God, even if it is just one statement, Holy Spirit, teach me your word. Holy Spirit, open this word to me. See, the Bible is like a room. As we enter this church from that door, and we start seeing different departments, different rooms, different sections, different things, chair table, that's the way the Bible is like a world on its own. It's like a movie. When you come into the Bible, you start seeing this part, that part, and you start catching revelation. You don't want to stop reading, because the Holy Spirit himself is revealing those things to you. But when you carry the Bible like, okay, Harry Potter. The way you read Harry Potter, Shakespeare, you want to read the Bible like that, you can't go far. You will sleep off. So you first have to pray for the Holy Spirit to interpret the Bible, open. Bible said to the concerning the disciples on their way to Emmaus. When Jesus rose from the dead and he was walking alongside with them, he said, and he opened their heart to understand the scripture. God himself must open your eyes to see life in his words. Unless I forget, because we are on Valentine's Day, you might say, oh, he's taking me too spiritual now. We are talking about love. Yes, explain to me my love life, my God and my love. How can I handle this? Let me tell you, God created sex. He created you. He created the opposite gender. Boys and girls, God created us. And he has a reason for that. God wants you to have relationship. But he wants you to have that relationship when the time is ripe. So why do you know the time is right? How do you know? You know the time is right when you are ready to take responsibility for that relationship. You know the time is right when you are not afraid to hide your girlfriend. When you are not afraid to hide your boyfriend. When you are ready to say, you know what, let's go see my mom and dad. Let's go meet my uncle. That is when maturity comes in. If you are still afraid, like, don't let them know what you are doing. Or, when we get to church, I will behave as if I don't know you. You behave as if I don't, you don't know me. Let my mommy not see your text in my phone. Or, I don't want, like, you know my mom. My mom will be screaming, you know my mom. Yeah, what is this? When did you start this? When did you like this? Who taught you this? You know you are afraid of that. You are afraid because you know your mommy will almost kill you. You know your daddy will complain. Everybody will be nagging you. They will look at you as a bad person. But let me tell you the truth. They also, at your age, they also went through the same temptation. Are you getting me? Do you know the man of God called Ryan Bonke? He's a great evangelist. You guys, you need to find out some stuff. Ryan Bonke was growing up. He was like your age. And he sat down in a train with his father. They were going to a revival. And he was asking his father, tell me about sex, sexuality, all these things. And his father was embarrassed to talk about it. Father was, Ryan, we are going to crusade. You should focus on God. You should not be thinking about negative things now. And he kept quiet. You know what happened after that? He said it in his book, autobiography, I'm reading it. And he said this. He said, since that day, my father dropped from the level of respect I had for him. And I decided that I'm going to focus on God to teach me about love, sex, marriage, himself. Are you getting me? So what you see in church, they don't want to talk about sex. They don't want to talk about courtship. They don't want to talk about marriage. All they want is,
you should be careful. You should be careful. I'm watching you.
No, we don't live in that world anymore. Hello? We live in this 21st century in the Western world where at 18, you are free to go and have a home of your own. If you are ready to have all it takes to pay your bills, to pick up the responsibility. So, what am I telling you today is that how do you undo yourself from here to there? What do you do while you wait for love? Why are you waiting to get to the point where you can have your own home, make your own babies, take your lady, your guy, go around the world and enjoy an affair? But as of now, the thing you need to do is number one, to love God. You know why? If you don't love God and you give all your heart to that guy, to that lady, God himself will make sure that heart is broken. Hello? God himself that you left. You know, God created everyone. He created heaven and earth, you and the person you are saying you love. Now, God said, love me with all your heart. You are saying, I love this lady. I love this guy. This guy said, he will do this, he will do that. He promised me everything. This lady dressed so well, and you know, whenever she walks, I feel like, ooh, she's beautiful. I'm thinking of so many things in my mind whenever I see her. And because of that, you said you can't love God. You know what God will do? God will allow your heart to go so far with this person, then he will allow you to get broken at it. Yeah, you start crying. You just see this guy with somebody else. See this lady kissing somebody. Say, oh my God! Then you're going to be broken at it. You're going to be crying. You'll be depressed. You'll be
tempted. Jerry Springer.
Then you now want to see solution to the problem on TV, which is not your problem. It's not going to work. So,
I'm not going to come here and say, you know what, don't involve in sex, because you know, if you get involved in sex, then there's disease.
Yeah.
No, I know there are diseases if people go and come, you know, involved in sex, you know, but then they also have a way around it. They get condom, they use contraceptive so that they don't get pregnant. Okay, so tell me, but there is something you guys don't know. Let me tell you that today. There are two things you need to know. I'm not telling you don't get into sex because of disease. I'm telling you don't get into sex now when you are not married because of your destiny. Hello? Because when I was growing up, they were scaring us of disease. I would say, oh, we can get a condom. There is sexually transmitted diseases, but you can prevent it with contraceptive. But do you know, ladies and young men, do you know that you cannot prevent sexually transmitted demons? You are screaming. You never heard of that before. Yes. You don't know that thing exists. So, you go and sleep with this lady. This lady is a witch, you don't know. She looks good. She's smiling, she's wearing good clothes, perfume, everything. Nice, you do. And it's okay. I mean, she looks okay to my eyes, but spiritual, she's not ordinary. This guy that you see is wearing good jeans and he's like, oh, yo, what's up, man? You feel me? You know, this guy that's doing all that, baby, I trust my heart. This lady, this guy, that is telling you good things, that person has a demon in him. I mean, that is what the Bible says, my son, if sinners entice you, consent thou not. If sinners, I'm looking from the book of Psalm chapter 1. Proverbs 1. Is it Proverbs 1? Psalm 1 verse 10, I believe. If sinners entice you, my son, consent thou not. Do not agree. Say, come with us. We'll go and do this. Let's go to this place. My daddy and mommy are not at home. We have a big house. We can use my room. Consent thou not. Hello? I don't know if I'm making sense to you guys. See, you know what? You know what? I'm a practical person. I don't deceive myself and I don't deceive people. Because when I was growing up, nobody taught me any of these things. This guy says, you cannot look for wife from God. You have to open your eyes, share your eyes, and look for somebody you like. Another person will say, you have to pray. If you want to get married, you should pray to God. You should not be looking around. See, I was confused. Which one should I follow? This person said,
Proverbs 1:10.
Thank you. Proverbs 1:10. Can somebody read it? I want you to see something today that will help you. At least for the rest of your life. You can open your heart to this. Proverbs 1:10. All right, go ahead.
My son, if sinners entice thee, consent thou not.
Thank you. If sinners entice thee, do you know what that means? God himself knows that you will be tempted. What is that? Sinners will come your way. Who are sinners? You say, oh, no, it's because this person is telling me that he loves me, she loves me. What does that mean? Make him or her a sinner? Come on. Me, I mean, oh, you guys are too spiritual. Oh, save me. Give me a break. Come on. I mean, we just say we love each other. We just friends. What's the big deal about that? We just making friendship. You know what? It starts with innocent friendship, and many times it ends with big belly. So, you become a pregnant lady, this guy runs away, and then he tells you to go get abortion, then you kill somebody because you love somebody. So, what I'm telling you today is, we're at the stage where we can't be like Solomon. I'm going back to where I started. First Timothy 3. We cannot be loving God and be loving the world. You have to, at this point in your life, commit all your heart to God and give your time to study the word, study your books, increase your skill, learn how to cook, maximize your potentials and giftings, learn leadership skills, find out what it means to be a leader, how to manage your home, how
how to help people, how to work on your talents and gifting. Can you sing? Can you write? Can you act? What do you know how to do? This is the stage of life to begin to think of that, so that you can mature quickly. When the time is right, then you can get married. Then you can do all whatever you want to do with your partner. I don't know if I make sense to somebody. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We give you praise for today. We magnify your holy name for the privilege to speak to your spirit. I'm asking that, Lord, you interpret the word in their heart and help them. Lead them in the way of righteousness. Let them commit all their hearts to you alone. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's put our hands together for Jesus.